The investigations are piling on, and now the federal special counsel office is looking into whether acting attorney general Matthew Whitaker may have received campaign donations while working as a federal employee. To former federal judge and independent counsel Ken Starr, author of Contempt, a memoir of the Clinton investigation. Good to see you, Ken. Thank you for being here.
Hey, David, good to see you. Thank you.
Let's talk first about this new news about the investigation of Mr. Whitaker. Could this actually force him out as acting attorney general?
Oh, I don't think so at all. It looks to me from what I've seen that this is one of those inadvertent failure to close down the campaign account in time. What will likely happen, and I've been through this sort of thing. I served as chief of staff to Attorney General Smith during the Reagan years, is he will have to simply pay this back. But unless there's any showing of intent, which I seriously doubt, this will be cleaned up. Call it a bureaucratic snafu.
Okay. Let's talk about his role as acting AG, and particularly his role overseeing the Mueller investigation. Exactly how much can he influence that investigation?
Well, under the regulations, David, he can influence major decisions, major steps. Now, that's not self-defining. That's a judgment call. But he cannot, under the regulations, interfere with the independence of the day-to-day operations. So let's just say, hypothetically, Robert Mueller was about to consider the indictment of one hypothetical Mary Roe. He needs to go to the acting attorney general and say, here's what I'm intending to do, and this is the reason why I'm to do it. And under the regulations, and these regulations have been in place since the late years of the Clinton administration, that's within the attorney general's prerogative to say yay or nay.
Well, let's take another even more specific hypothetical, if you will. Say Mr. Whitaker finds out that Mr. Mueller is looking into something with the Trump business empire that precedes his running for president. Could Mr. Whitaker say, hey, wait a minute, that's out of bounds. That's not what you were hired for.
Yes, he does have that authority. The Attorney General has that authority under the regulations. He will need to provide in the fullness of time an explanation to Congress as to why he made that decision. But he does have that authority.
Wow. Now, the president has, as we all know now, written out the answers to Mr. Mueller. I don't know if they're actually within Mr. Mueller's hands right now and if he's going over them. But what is your thinking about these written answers? Is there any danger for the president? Because clearly he went over them very carefully with his lawyers to make sure that there weren't any mistakes in there.
Well, there's always a danger, but obviously the press is well served by extremely able lawyers. They, I'm sure, were extremely careful about this. They know what they're doing. And in a way, it's a symbolic victory for the president in that he has not been summoned to testify, at least as far as we know, right? Maybe there's been an invitation to testify live. But written questions, written answers, and so forth are a safe and secure way of providing information to the special counsel. So, yes, these answers presumably are in Bob Mueller's hands, and so I would expect the classic give-and-take process. Hey, your answer to question number three, Mr. President, with all due respect, raises a couple of other questions, and it'll be this negotiation back-and-forth process, I assume. And so it's a sort of stay tuned. But it does suggest, you're absolutely right, that Mr. Mueller is very far along in his investigation, at least with respect to the allegation of collusion. And again, I've seen nothing. I don't think the American people have seen anything to suggest that there was collusion.
No, zero on that. But there have been a lot of indictments for people, you know, insiders inside the Beltway, for what they did as lobbyists, et cetera. There were some Russians who probably will never make it to trial because they're going to stay in Russia. But of all the information that Mr. Mueller has collected, and there are probably reams and reams of information.
Yes.
Is it conceivable that the written answers of the president would conflict in any way from the evidence that Mr. Mueller has collected?
Well, it's conceivable, but I don't think that it's likely. Again, anything can happen. Someone can go awry. You can have a witness who says X and the president says not X. But I think the process, especially with able lawyers, is being guided in such a way that the president is answering truthfully, I hope and pray, and that those answers, in fact, are not going to in any way implicate him. You mentioned the indictments very quickly. One of the lessons that has come out again with respect to the Mueller investigation is tell the truth, right? Indictments for perjury, guilty pleas for perjury, and so forth. And that, of course, was exactly the genesis of what unfolded during the Lewinsky phase, as I recount in my book, David.
All right. Judge Starr, great to see you, my friend. Thank you for being here. Really appreciate you coming in.
My pleasure, David.
Thank you. And the book, by the way, is Contempt.